Hello everyone, welcome back again to my YouTube channel. Thank you very much for your love and support. As always, I remain loyal. So those of us that are coming across this channel for the first time, this is Agatha Progress Channel, and I come across your way every blessed day. In this channel, as you can see, we bring the latest and we bring the happening all over the globe. And in this channel also, we react to all videos. Yes, all videos, and I do hope you join the family. Right now, this video you are about to watch, I don't know what you felt about this video, but I hope you do pick some sense from this video. All right, let's dive into the news in details.
It is getting so interesting. The leader of Biafra, Mazi Nnamdi Kanu, has come out to hit the nail, to blow the whistle, to blow the trumpets. They must definitely kill Biafra. And Biafrans will also kill them. As far as he is concerned, he is not afraid of anything and he remains unshakable, unmovable, unrunnable. He's a very strong and determined. I have a video here that we are going to watch, and I will be watching the video with you on some of his speech and what he believed and how he believed that Biafra must definitely come to pass. A lot of people might doubt his intelligence. A lot of people might doubt his wisdom, but he believes in who he is. And in Biafra, most definitely conquered. All right, let me upload the video. Let us watch the video together and drop your opinion in the comment section.
As an indivisible force, in order for us to demand what rightfully belongs to us, which is freedom. Today is a very critical day in the history of our people. We are remembering those who we are slaughtered and massacred unjustly by the Nigerian government and, of course, by extension, the British government as well. We are remembering those who died as a result of the unofficial Third World War that took place in our land nearly 54 years ago. And as a result of that, this very day, as we renew this pledge every blessed year, we have sworn to forever remember these people. We must remember them because the Jews do the same. All over the world, people remember their dead. In Rwanda, the same thing happens. And I don't know why there is this, should I say, conspiracy of silence to try to sweep this very important event in our history under the carpet. We lost over 5 million people, the second worst genocide in the history of man, only second to the Jewish Holocaust in Europe. And for some inexplicable reason, the world has decided to keep silence over this very matter. But we are not going to keep silence, not at all. Not now, not tomorrow, not ever. We are going to vigorously and relentlessly pursue this very effort to recognize the genocide that was committed against Biafran people, without apologies to anyone. It is a very good thing that before we came on air, I think the Ebonyi State government have now rescinded the threat they issued to all those who were intending to stay at home tomorrow. That is also commendable. It is not very often that I commend people, but I must say that I also commend Governor Willie Obiano, which I don't do very often, for the very critical work that he did today by laying a wreath at the cenotaph that he built for those that fell, for those that made it possible for us to remain alive this very day. I must say this to our people, those who are living, that it is because of the sacrifice of those brave men and women that is the singular reason why we are not suffering the same fate as those of them from the Middle Belt, and to a very limited extent, those of our brothers and brethren from Oduduwa Republic. Why am I saying this? It is only in our land today that we do not have any significant presence of Fulani terrorist organizations in our bushes or in our forests. And why is that the case? Because our fathers taught us how to fight. They fought for Biafra unaided, unassisted for over 3 years. We fought the two strongest major powers in the world at that time, the USSR and Great Britain. Egypt fought against us. The OAU was against us, with the exception of the likes of Julius Nyerere and Wilfred Brenner of Cote d'Ivoire. We suffered immeasurably. And now, like then, Israel was under attack and they couldn't provide any meaningful help. But we survived it. not out of our own might, not out of our own power, we survived it because God Almighty in heaven was with us. And this generation have now come to complete the work that those of them of 1970 started. And we are not going to stop. I want the world to understand me very clearly. We are not going to stop. It doesn't matter what it takes. It doesn't matter how many lives they extinguish. It doesn't matter the genocidal tendencies they bring with them into our land. We are not going to stop. Everybody listening, everybody watching, everybody remotely interested in justice and peace must understand this. Our destination is freedom, and that very place we're heading to is Biafra. And nobody, no soul on this earth can stop us. Instead of Biafra not to come, we all perish. I want our adversaries, our enemies to understand this very, very clearly. We are not going to retreat, not one iota, not one inch, because Biafra must come. Because the hatred has continued to this very day. As I'm speaking and addressing all of you right now, they are still arresting extrajudicially murdering people in our land, people who are alien to our culture, our way of life, our tradition. They are in our land directing their people to slaughter, to kill without mercy. Unfortunately, those we regard as political leaders have connived with these people to ensure the decimation of their own population. That is the type of nonsense we can no longer condone. As you all know, there is no significant Fulani presence in our land because our fathers taught us how to fight. And we are doing so today without apologies to any idiot. We are not going to apologize. Because we have been apologizing for nearly 50 years. And we have not gotten anywhere in terms of our collective advancement and development in the damnable geological republic called Nigeria. That is why we must know what we're doing. And that is why anybody who is remotely interested in the affairs of our people must understand this, that we are determined, doubly determined. 50 years, or should I say 54 years, is a very long time, and 51 years since the end of the war. But now that we have come, or should I say now that God Almighty in heaven, that we should come, we are not going to relent. We are not going to do anything whatsoever to jeopardize the sanctity and the holiness of this very issue. We love our people. We love every ethnic nationality that makes up Nigeria as it is presently constituted. We have no hatred towards anybody. We love peace. We love life. We love the progress of other people. But we are in a country where people hate us for no reason, where people despise us for no reason. And we can no longer go on apologizing. And Nigeria as a state, the entire Africa as a continent, must acknowledge. The same way they acknowledge the genocide in Rwanda, they must rise up to acknowledge the genocide in Biafra land. Or else there will be no peace nor development in the whole of Africa. And I'm not saying it apologetically. I am stating a fact that ought to be forcefully demanded for. And Biafra itself must be restored for those who have come before us, for their sacrifice, for their courage, for their gallantry and their bravery. It is a very good thing today that one of the co-hosts here is on our board, Adele, a man that I cherish and I appreciate very much, and also the very excellent work that Mazi is doing. But let us make this thing very, very clear. We are wronged by the Nigerian state, by every ethnic group in Nigeria. I know that my good friend and brother, Obadiah Mailafia, rang me and apologized a while ago for the role that they played in the massacre of Biafran people, the role that they played in aiding and abetting a very unlawful invasion of Biafra land, because all Ojukwu asked for was restructuring. The same thing we are arguing for today. Ojukwu went to Aburi to argue for restructuring. Ojukwu did not go to Aburi to declare any state of Biafra. He never went to Aburi to declare any war. Ojukwu went to Aburi so that all of us in Nigeria, including those from the Middle Belt, from the West, everywhere can have freedom. This is something we're asking for today. They twisted the narrative. They changed our history. They turned it upside down. They made us the villain. they tried to demonize our general, a man of peace, that went to Aburi in Accra to go and in Ghana to go and negotiate for peace. A peace that Britain prevailed upon go on, not implement. But over the years, we've been taught that we were the aggressors. Such nonsense can no longer hold, it can no longer obtain, and that is why, as I said earlier, unapologetically, we are pursuing the freedom of Biafra, and nobody can stop us. Anybody on our path is going to fall, is going to die. Instead of Biafra not to come, every living organism in Nigeria will die, I swear to God Almighty in heaven, because we are not going back. It is a good thing today that some notable Nigerians are on this very platform discussing what transpired 54 years ago. Most have tweeted to say, may it not happen again. The only way to ensure that this will not happen again is the existence of a free, sovereign Biafran nation. That is the only panacea, nothing more, nothing less. Before we came here, Larigbo Market was on fire. These vandals and vagabonds are in our land killing people relentlessly. That's